crown from the darkness. The battle belongs to the Lord and no one else. You're the banner we raise in the chaos. No, the gates of hell won't stand against us. We're born curious. We were created to be. We ask, we question, we learn and grow. We've always been explorers, adventurers, dreamers and innovators. Asking what, how and why. And there's so much more to explore together. New stories, new adventures, new loves. New joy. We're born curious. Stay curious. Try Alpha.
Ready?
Wow. Soul restoration. That's good, isn't it? Well, much of the themes, actually some of the themes coming out of that song, we didn't speak, Nat and I, but actually you'll see there's sort of parallels and consistencies. So just pause in a moment in the quiet, just to settle your thoughts, not to push the things that trouble you out of your mind. We don't do that. But actually just to be mindful that you're in the Lord's presence, because whenever we come together, it's because he wants to impart something in us. He wants to confirm something. He wants to bring some comfort, some healing, lead us forward. So you're here because the Lord wants to connect with you. So let's pause just for a moment in the silence and be mindful of his presence. Thank you, Lord, that you are here. May we be mindful of your presence. May we connect with you as you connect with us. In your precious name we come. In your precious name we are called. Amen. Well, as I said at the beginning of the service, some of you may be looking at the next season ahead with anticipation and excitement and an air of, mystery about what you're doing next. But also, as I think we probably established at the beginning of the service, that some of you may feel disillusioned, you may feel dejected. It could be with your life situation, the changes that are happening. Maybe your life isn't where you thought it would be at this time for whatever reason. Maybe it struggles with your family. Maybe, heaven forbid, the thought of going back to school doesn't fill you with excitement. I was one of the rare children, it didn't fill me with excitement. And there may be some here listening online. For you, you're one of those odd ones that it doesn't fill you with excitement. For others of you, you've come back from the summer break and you're facing the reality of work. Maybe it's illness you're facing. Maybe loneliness. Maybe it's facing life without someone you are desperate to embrace, to kiss, to hold. That for you, you're facing the struggle of death. For others of you, you're facing the struggle of life. Well, today in this message, we're going to join two disciples that when we join them are dejected and they are disillusioned, because they'd walked with Jesus and they were confident that he was the deliverer, he was the savior, he was the Messiah. They were excited about where this all led. But all that changed when they saw him arrested, beaten, crucified. They saw him die, and then they saw him laid in a tomb. So everything they hoped for seemed to be dashed, and that's where we're going to join them on their journey. We're going to join them on a wonderful journey on the road to Emmaus, a well-known passage of Scripture, and we're going to see what we can learn from how Jesus comes alongside them, what we can learn the way he comes alongside us, but also that actually the way Jesus comes alongside them is also how we can learn to come alongside others that are also struggling. Now, the full passage of scripture is Luke 24, verses 13 to 35, and I'm just going to move through with key scriptures as we move through the story. But that's the context, what we're going to join them. Picking up verse 13 of Luke 24. Now, that same day, two of the disciples were going to a village called Emmaus, about 7 miles from Jerusalem. They were talking with each other about everything that had happened. They're talking about everything that had happened. And it says the same day. What day is this? This is actually Resurrection Sunday. Jesus had in fact risen from the dead, yet they were heading back home unaware of all that had happened. Even though Jesus had told them that he would suffer, told them that he would die, told them that he would rise again. Matthew 16, 21, he explained to the disciples that he must go to Jerusalem, that he must suffer many things, that he must be killed and on the third day be raised to life. They'd had the scripture. How many times have you had a scripture from the Lord and you've believed it and you've held on to it? But then the events unfold. And let's be honest, church, we struggle. Can I have a hands up? Is if suddenly you know what the Word of God says, but somehow it's difficult to walk in it. When you are overwhelmed with the pain of the present, you're overwhelmed, you don't have peace in the present, and you start to lose faith for the future. And let's be honest, we do all get there. We do get there. And Jesus knows that. Jesus understands that at times we will lack faith. And because we lack faith, we know that he is always faithful. He knows we struggle. He sees we struggle. He doesn't judge us for our lack of faith. In fact, he comes alongside us in his faithfulness with his grace. In verse 15, it says, they talked and discussed these things with each other, and Jesus himself came up and walked along with them. And I think that is mind-blowing. The high King of heaven, the Lord of all creation, the one that when he speaks, planets and galaxies are born. He's a busy guy. The first acts of the risen Savior were to go in search of individuals that were struggling. Why? Because he is a personal Savior that wants a personal relationship with every one of his children. He saw these disciples and he sees you. In the midst of the crowd, in the midst of the challenge, he sees you. Even in your doubts, he is with you. Even in your struggles, he is with you. His walk with you is a personal walk. Whatever you are facing, he is completely interested in you. He sees you. He walks with you. He has time for you. It's an amazing truth. He didn't seek to order the amphitheater to fill it with thousands of people because he'd risen to tell the world. He didn't make appointments with all the governors, all the great and the good and the powerful. He didn't go to speak to large crowds. He didn't even go to the temple to preach. He said, no, some of my children are struggling. That's where I'm needed. Isn't that an amazing truth? That the priority of the risen Christ is to seek out those that are struggling. Now, when we struggle, as they struggled, all of their dreams are dashed. They'd invested their time and they thought the dream was over. And often when we struggle, we ruminate. Anyone ruminate over things in your mind? You're amazing at waking up at 2 a.m. and worrying. Hands up if you don't need any lessons in how to worry. Just show of hands. You guys have a spiritual anointing. I do. I'm amazing at it. I don't know how. It's a gift. It's a gift. We ruminate over things. Psychiatrists call it inner monologue. We do it. Self-talk. We go through self-talk, but healing only takes place when our inner monologue becomes outer dialogue. When the inner monologue becomes outer dialogue, which is why prayer is so powerful and necessary, because it takes that inner monologue and we start having an outer dialogue with Jesus. And as we start to talk things through, when we spend time with him, we start to realize, wait a second, there's a different perspective. Why do we have counseling? Counseling is about taking that inner monologue and helping someone turn it into outer dialogue. Because as you start to talk things through, suddenly things become different. It's why we have the bereavement cafe. We cannot solve the fact of someone losing their loved one. But taking that inner monologue, turning it into outer dialogue, it helps us walk that journey of healing. Just by speaking it through, you realize you're not alone and actually others are going through similar things. We need to talk to one another. So Jesus comes alongside them. It says he came himself and walked along with them, Luke 24, verse 15. He came to walk with them personally, talk with them, and most importantly, he came to listen. He does the same with you and he does the same with me. He joins them on their journey. Jesus himself joins these two disciples on their journey. And it wasn't a quick conversation. Now, if you're the Son of God, I think you can probably solve most issues in about, what, a millisecond? But he joins them on their journey. It's not a short walk. 7 miles in that terrain is like to be 3 hours or so. 3 hours, he gently catches up. He falls into their pace, into their step, into their rhythm, and walks alongside them. Verse 16 of Luke 24 says, he went with them, but they were kept from recognizing him. He was with them. He was with them, but they didn't recognize him. And this, to me, speaks volumes. Sometimes he can be with us. In fact, he's always with us. But we don't necessarily recognize his presence. Just because you do not recognize his presence with you, it does not mean that he is not with you. He is omnipresent. We know that. That means he can be everywhere simultaneously at the same time, 100% in every single interaction and meeting. He is there. It's why it says in Hebrews 13:5, he will never, ever, ever leave us or forsake us, to show he is permanently present. The fact you are all alive at this moment is because you are breathing in life-giving oxygen. It is present in this space. If it was not, I would be facing a very different crowd of people right now. The fact is, life-giving oxygen is there. You cannot see it, but you are breathing it in. You are being sustained through its life-giving properties. The air we breathe, the Holy Spirit is here. The very fact we are here, he is with us, whether you recognize it or not. The air is invisible, but it is present. And sometimes, I don't know about you, we can feel invisible. We can feel that we're not seen, but you are visible to him. There is nowhere you can escape from his presence. You may feel lost, you may feel alone, but you are not lost to him. He knows exactly how to find you. In fact, when someone is lost, what is the second question you ask them? The first one is, what's the first one? Where do you want to be? Where do you want to go to? Don't you? And the next one is, where are you now? Where do you want to get to? But you need to know where they're at now, don't you? Otherwise, your directions are absolutely meaningless. You ask them where they're heading, but then you want to know where they are now. And unless we establish where someone is now, how on earth can we help them? Yet we do it all the time. Let me give you some advice based on my experience. You don't even know their problem yet, but you're willing to steam in there with a load of good advice when you haven't even heard the problem. What do counselors do? Ask open questions. They ask open questions. Why? What? Who? When? Where? How? They want to know where you want to get to, but they want to know where you're at now. How can they start to help you if they don't understand what you're going through now? And that's effectively what Jesus does in this conversation. He's establishing where they are at now. Verse 17, lovely open question. What are you discussing together as you walk along? What are you discussing together as you walk along? Jesus is the answer to all of our problems. Amen? He could have just told them, it's me. I have all the answers to every question. But he models the behavior that we should as well. He seeks to ask questions to help them understand what they were facing, to help them unpack it, and he listens graciously, something we should learn to do. If the Savior of the world, who has every answer, takes time to ask people questions, maybe he's telling us we should be doing the same. How do you know where someone truly is? If you don't ask them questions and listen to the answers. Look at the New Testament. How often does Jesus ask questions? He asks questions of people. What's going on? What do you want from me? He's allowing them to unpack that inner monologue and turn it into outer dialogue. He asks questions. Do you ask questions? Anyone always in a rush? Some of you are reluctant to put your hands up because, you know, people will judge you for it. We're a gracious church. I'm sure Jesus was incredibly busy being the saviour of the world. After you'd risen from the dead, would you be investing hours with two disciples that weren't in the top 12? These weren't the Premier League guys. There's Cleopas and the other guy. They're not. But he invests time. He invests time. He takes time out. Do we take time out? He always makes time for us. Do we make time for him? Do we make time for others? When you journey with someone, it takes unhurried time. Why do people go to counsellors? Because often there's no one else that will listen to them. Sometimes we just want someone to listen to us. Journeying with people takes time. In Brazil, one of the most fantastic things we did was having time with one another. I got to know the young ones. Where do they want to head in life? And where are they now? It was a fantastic time. A brilliant time. We got to know one another deeply. Didn't we, Caleb? Didn't we, Amelie? Was it cool? We learned all kinds of things about each other. What happened in Brazil stays in Brazil. So yeah, we'll be praying about some of these things for deliverance for us. For the first 5 days, we had no Wi-Fi in the room we were staying in. So for 5 days, we had to talk. It was brilliant. As soon as Wi-Fi came back on, I knew the top of their heads intimately. I just saw a sea of heads on the phone. But what do you value in life? If you say, oh, I value my family and my friends. Oh, and I value Jesus. Okay, let's do an audit of your day. Well, it seems that your very best friend is your phone. You spent 8 hours with them. Is that what you want? Is that your real priority? Is that what's going to change your life? Are those 8 hours what you want and you believe is going to transform your life? Does what you do with your time signify where the importance is? And if it doesn't, you need to ask yourself the question why. We had time, and it was an amazing gift from the Lord. We need to cultivate time with Jesus, and we need to cultivate time with others if we're going to walk this journey together. If someone comes up to you and they've got a problem and you're rushed in time, don't look at your watch or look at your phone. Be honest. Say, look, I'd love to speak to you about this. I just haven't got time. I often say that on Sundays. I'd love to speak to you. Drop me a line. We'll meet in the week and we can do this in an unhurried way and the phones will be off. Tell someone. Tell them that you value them. You need to cultivate other time because certain things cannot be rushed. Relationships cannot be rushed. Healing cannot be rushed. Transformation takes time sometimes. I wish it didn't. I wish God would just step in and things. Do you wish that God would just step in and change things?
Yes.
Gosh. But sometimes he has this agenda when it takes time. Is it annoying to you? He's not listening at this point. It annoys me. I think, Lord, I know what you could do. You could do it really quickly now. It would make my life a lot easier. And everyone else's as well. But transformation takes time. Just because it doesn't happen in the time scale we want, it doesn't mean it won't happen. It doesn't mean that Jesus is not working. He was working in the lives of these two disciples even before they knew he was working, even before they even knew it was him with them. So we need to have that patience with ourselves to be transformed, but also show that patience with others. And when we invest that time with Jesus, when we start to walk with him, when we turn some other things off and we spend time in those down times, not turning on a phone or turning on the TV, but just saying, I'm going to sit here in this time and I'm going to just spend time with him. It's amazing how you'll start to hear him when you invest time with him, but also how you see a transformation in others when you spend time with them. Who likes to be listened to? Hands up. Obviously, some of you have nothing good to say. You think, don't listen to me. If you want to be listen to others first. Listen to others. If you want them to listen to what you have to say, listen to what they have to say. Otherwise, they won't listen to you. And when you spend time, time builds trust. When you spend time with Jesus, you build trust in Jesus. And once you trust him, when he speaks truth, you start to believe it. It starts to transform your situation. When you spend time with others, when you are for them, they start to trust you. And when they trust you, you start to be able to speak truth into their lives and bring transformation. Why would people listen to you if you don't listen to them? Jesus speaks truth because, first of all, he builds rapport. He asks questions. He listens. And then he realizes this is what they need to hear. And in verse 25, very lovingly, he says, "How foolish you are. Unless you're the Son of God, don't start a conversation that way. And how slow to believe all that the prophets have spoken." Now, I'm only joking. What Jesus actually says in the actual Greek translation, foolish means lack of understanding. He says, "I've heard your issue, and there's some lack of understanding." So he introduces some useful additional information. He says to them what the prophets have said. And we do that in the bereavement cafe. When we listen to people, we often bring some additional information to help them understand. Actually, what you're experiencing is okay. This is what you can expect to. Just by giving that extra information, people think, wow, I hadn't thought of it that way. This is okay. I'm not on my own. Others have experienced what I'm experiencing. When you come alongside and listen, you start to be able to speak into somebody's life. In that unhurried atmosphere, you spend time and you begin to turn that inner monologue into outer dialogue. And then when you do give advice, or I like to say options is a better way to approve it, it's based on what you've actually heard to be true rather than what you think to be true. Yeah? Because you've taken time to listen. He'd listened to them and they were ready to listen to him. Verse 27, beginning with Moses, he says, "And all the prophets, he explained to them what was said in all the scriptures about himself." He'd been patient, he'd been gracious, and then he brought truth afterwards. What does it say about Jesus Christ? "We beheld his glory, full of what? Grace and truth." John 1:14. Grace precedes truth. Grace precedes truth. If we take the time to come alongside someone and ask questions and listen, when we start to show grace and they know we are for them, then the door opens for us to speak truth into their lives. Grace precedes truth. He is gracious with us and we need to show more grace to others. Grace first, understand before you speak truth. And what does truth do? Sets us free. John 8:32, "You will know the truth," Jesus says, "and the truth will set you free." He is truth. When we speak truth, it brings freedom to us and others. Luke 24:28, "They approached the village to which they were going. Jesus continued on as if he was going further, but they urged him strongly, 'Stay with us. Stay with us, for it's nearly evening. The day's almost over.' So he went in to stay with them. When he was at the table with them, he took bread, he gave thanks, he broke it, and he began to give it to them." They were desperate for him to stay with them. Why? They didn't know he was the Son of God then, but someone that walked the journey, someone that built rapport, someone that asked questions, someone that listened, someone that gave them useful information. In the walking, he was working. In the waiting, he'd been working. Even before you recognize it in your life, he is working. In your grief, he is working. In your pain, he is working. In your fear, he is working. In your apprehension about going back to school or college or university, he is working. Whatever cross you are carrying, he is working. He is always at work. They didn't realize it until their eyes were opened and they saw what was always there, that the Lord was with them. Verse 31, "Then their eyes were opened and they recognized him and he disappeared from their sight." They recognized he'd been with them all along and he is with you. Whether you recognize his presence, whether you feel that tingle on the back of your neck, he is still with you and he is still working before you even recognize it. He has a plan before you've even thought of where you're heading. He already knows the destination. He knows the end from the beginning. And they realized he had been with them. Verse 32, they say, "Were not our hearts burning within us while he talked with us on that road and he opened the scriptures to us?" Their hope was restored. Their hearts began to burn again. A fire in their belly started to well up. A spark of hope. Jesus can set hearts on fire again. Whatever you need, he wants to put that spark back in you. That fire again in your belly. That faithfulness to keep going. because he is with you and he has a plan and he has a destination. Whether you experience him, whether you know he's with you or not, he is working. He can cause the coldest heart to thaw. He can give you a heart's desire at the proper time, give you a new purpose. He is a restorer of hope for the hopeless. Can I have an amen? Gives me a chance to have some water. Say amen again. You're with us. That's good. When you walk with him, you still have to face certain things. I wanted him, if I was a Christian at the time, to deliver me from school. I would have loved it. I shouldn't say that in front of you guys, but I did. Sometimes he's not going to take you out of the circumstance, but he'll take you through it. Amen? He will be with you, and he won't necessarily change the circumstance, but he will change how you see it when you recognize he is with you. He can bring you that peace in the midst of the pain. He can bring you a purpose and a new perspective. The disciples' perspective on this walk was one of defeat, one of failure, one of dashed dreams. The crucifixion, based on the facts, signified it was the end for all they dreamed of. But through the lens of God, through the word of God, through the plan of God, they found out it was only the beginning. Amelie loves reading books. It was only the beginning of the greatest story ever written. The greatest rescue of all time was coming into focus through the pain and the horror of the cross. And Jesus came in and changed their perspective. The pain of the cross led to the wonder of the resurrection. Jesus' deepest pain on the cross meant to be the purpose for all mankind. And even your deepest pain can be a purpose, not just for you, reveal a purpose, but for others as well. Because the pain of these two disciples, when they walked with Jesus, changed. And they went on the other side of that disillusionment and downheartedness to share the good news with others. They wanted others to know the blessing they had. Verse 33, they got up. They were probably really tired. They're probably like we were in Brazil. And they returned at once to Jerusalem. There they found the 11 and those with them, assembled together. Then the two told what had happened on the way and how Jesus was recognized by them when he broke the bread. Because Jesus had come alongside them at their hardest time. And when they'd been transformed, they were willing to go on and bring a blessing to others, to invest their time on the 7-mile journey back. Because they wanted others to be blessed. They knew others were struggling the way they had, and they could be the solution to that pain. Two men who just hours before were disillusioned, dejected, and downhearted, transformed through the healing power and presence of the Savior that walks life with us. And they set off to bless others who were struggling as they had. You know, we can do the same. The fact you're here today means whatever life has thrown at you, you're here now. You've come through every challenge. And each time you come through a challenge, something's deposited in you and you experience a bit of knowledge that you can use to bless others that may be going through a similar situation and journey to you. We're reminded of that in 2 Corinthians chapter 1, verses 3 to 5. It says, all praise to the God and Father of our Master, Jesus Christ, the Messiah, the Father of all mercy, the God of all healing counsel. He comes alongside us when we go through hard times. And before you know it, he brings us alongside someone else who is going through hard times so that we can be there for that person, just as God was there for us. They recognized he comforted them. He was there for them. And they thought, we can go and bring that comfort to others as well. Whatever your journey, whatever your failure, whatever your hard time, not only does God bring you through, but it can have significance in unlocking something in someone else's life. Out of the horror of the cross for Jesus Christ, out of that came the greatest purpose the world has ever seen, the Savior of mankind. What can he bring out of your pain, out of your struggle, out of your suffering? Not just for you, but for others as well. So as I bring this to close, what do we learn? We learned of all the great things Jesus could have done. He saw two individuals that were struggling, and he walked with them. Even when they didn't realize it, he was with them. He sees you and he is with you as well. This story isn't in the scriptures by accident. He's showing you the value he has on you. You are important to him. He's interested in your life. He will ask questions of you, but he will listen to you. He will be patient with you. He will invest time with you. He will show you grace when you do not deserve it. That's what grace is. He will be faithful to you even when you are unfaithful to him. So walk with him. Cultivate time with him. Press into him. Listen to him. And act on his truth, because it does lead to a road of blessing. Trust his timing. You'll come through your fears. You'll come through the pain. He knows the person you want to be with, and he knows the person you want to be. And journeying with him ultimately ends well. He is the Son of God. He is God himself. When you journey with him, the destination always ends well. So walk with him. But also, we're sons and daughters of the King. We need to be Jesus to others. Do the same for others. Walk with them. Ask them questions. Cultivate time. Listen to them. Listen to them and pray that the Lord gives you some godly wisdom to speak into their lives. Be patient. Be gracious. You don't walk their journey. They may struggle with things that you wouldn't dream you ever would, but actually for them it's a big cross. Be gracious. Show understanding. And recognize, even in your most difficult moments of pain, it can release the purpose in someone else, bring peace to someone else. Even in your brokenness, someone else can be released in a journey of blessing. So don't be frightened of your pain. It's not wasted. The cross wasn't wasted for Jesus, and your cross, whatever it is, isn't wasted for you or for others that he puts in your path. Amen. So you pause your head and pause your thoughts, bow your head. I'm quite relaxed now, I'm still tired. So the Holy Spirit, let the Holy Spirit minister to you just in the quiet for a moment, and just let things percolate. What's he saying to you? Thank you, Lord, that you are the one that leaves the 99 that are in safety to seek the one that is struggling. Thank you, Lord, that these opening stories after the resurrection, the women that saw you at the tomb, these disciples on the road to Emmaus, show us that you see us, that we are important to you. The world may overlook us. We may feel lonely in a crowd, isolated, but you see us. Thank you that you want to walk with us, that you are interested in our story. And as we get close to you, we learn your story for us. Lord, may we cultivate that time with you, walk with you, listen to you, and experience your presence, your healing, your rest, your peace, the fact that your burden is light. Lord, may we learn from your example. May we recognize, even in our deepest and darkest moments of pain, when you bring us through, Lord, that we can actually help others struggling in similar situations, not because we have all the answers for them, but we can walk the journey with them. Help us to walk with those you place around us. Help us to prioritize the things we should, to ask questions, to listen, to walk the journey with those around us. May we be gracious, Lord. May we show grace as we bring truth. Lord, take us all on a journey. A journey as individuals. A journey as a church. a journey with every church throughout this nation and throughout this world. And may we know, ultimately, we will end in glory, because every journey with you leads to glory. Thank you, Jesus. Amen.
Thanks, Ryan. Just as he was preaching, I just checked that he's happy with me to share this with you. I felt there was maybe one person, there was one person here. I don't know if they're here or if they're listening or if they will be listening online, but you have one person in your work situation that is causing you a lot of distress. And I felt that God says he wants to speak into that situation. So I'd like to encourage you to come up for prayer after the service. We have people here who pray. They have a badge on them and they come to the front, and they're here for people to pray with people. So if that's you and you are here, please take that opportunity, because I really feel like God wants to speak into that situation.
Tried so hard to see it, took me so long to believe it, that you choose someone like me to carry your victory. Perfection could never earn it. You give what we don't deserve. You take them to glory. You are my champion. Giants fall when we stand undefeated. Every battle you've won. I am who you say I am. You crown me with confidence. I am seated in the heavenly place, undefeated, with the one who has conquered it all. Now I can finally see it. You're teaching me how to receive it. So let all striving cease. This is my victory. You are my champion. Giants fall when you stand undefeated. Every battle you've won. I am who you say I am. You crown me with confidence. I am seated in the heavenly place, undefeated, with the one who has conquered it all. Oh. Oh. When I lift my voice and shout, every wall comes crashing. I lift my voice and shout. Every wall comes crashing down. I have the authority Jesus has given me. When I open up my mouth, miracles start breaking out. I have the authority Jesus has given me. And you are my champion. Giants fall when you stand undefeated. Every battle you've won, I am who you say I am. You crown me with confidence. I am seated in the heavenly place undefeated. Power of your name I am seated in the heavenly place undefeated. With the one who has conquered it all. Oh. Ooh. Let's sing that part again. Let's sing the bridge again. When I lift my voice and shout, every wall comes crashing down. I have the authority Jesus has given me. When I open up my mouth, miracles start breaking out. I have the authority Jesus has given me. When I lift my voice and shout, every wall comes crashing down. I have the authority Jesus has given me. Giants fall when you stand undefeated. Every battle you've won, I am who you say I am. You crown me with confidence. I am seated in the heavenly place undefeated. By the power of your name, I am seated in the heavenly place undefeated, with the one who has conquered it all.
Yes, Jesus. Yes, Lord. Thank you, Jesus.
There's a table that you've prepared for me in the presence of my enemy. It's your body and your blood you shed for me. This is how I fight my battle. There's a table that you've prepared for me in the presence of my enemy. It's your body and your blood you shed for me. This is how I fight my battle.
Hallelujah. We're going to keep worshiping in a moment, and I know there's a couple of people that have heard something from the Lord they're going to share in a moment. But it's interesting in the song, doesn't it? It says about preparing a table in the presence of our enemies. And we say, wow, we've got time to eat in the presence of our enemies? You have, if you're hidden in Christ. The Bible says that when we receive Jesus Christ, we're hidden. So wherever the enemy looks at you, he has to do it through the filter of Jesus Christ. No one can get past the Lion of the tribe of Judah. He is more powerful than every adversary, and you are surrounded by him. Therefore, you can sit in the presence of your enemies, your fears, your doubts, your uncertainty, because he is surrounding you and in you. Whatever it is. Word for somebody here, you think the door's closed. You think the door's closing and God's speaking to you. He says, the door's not closed. I'm going to kick it open. Don't give up. The door is going to be opened. Keep going. Don't give up. Don't hear what's being said. Step out. He's going to kick that door down. The door is going to be opened for somebody here. Okay, amen. If that's you, the door's not closed. The door will be opened. Stand firm. The Lord has spoken. Every person that tries to shut the door will not be able to. I'm going to invite a couple up now. Elspeth first, you've got a word from the Lord. Do you want to, are you happy to come up and share it? God uses all of his church to speak to us, yeah?
Okay, so I kept on getting a picture of great big cobbles, but with big gaps between them that are really black. And I just had a sense that there's someone here that feels as though they're in that real deep crevice that God can't reach. And I just had the sense that, no, God reaches in, just like sunlight gets into anything, or like roots get into anything. God will get into that situation with you and help you to come out of it.
Bless you. If that's you, just ponder that for a moment. In the dark and the dirt, in that crevice, his light still shines. His light still shines.
I'm afraid to share it, and I'm fighting the battle today by sharing it. I saw a picture of a large mirror which was badly damaged on the back, so it was no longer a complete mirror. As I looked, I saw hands pouring gold on the back of the mirror to make it new and complete again. If it speaks to you, come to the front and get prayed for afterwards. Thank you.
Now, can I just say, if you've received something today, whether it's through the worship, through the prayer time, through a word that's shared, through something in the message, remember, that is the Lord reaching you. He spoke to those disciples on the road to Emmaus, but he used them to bring the good news to the others. And so remember, through you, you can bless others. So I just want you in the final song as Nat leads us, just as we lead into it, open your hands if you just want to receive something from the Lord. You know what you need. He knows what you need. Just open your hands, and just as a sign that you're just reaching out to him, that you need something from him. And as you worship him, remember, you're worshiping the High King of Heaven, the one that knows the end from the beginning. Just reach out and just let him minister to you. Reach out. He knows your need. Reach out to him and let him just reach you in the way that only he can. And as Pat said, I will be at the front with Pat afterwards. If anyone wants prayer, then please come forward. I would be delighted to pray with you. Amen.
Song we could ever sing, worthy of all the praise we could ever bring, worthy of every breath we could ever breathe, we live for you. Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever say, worthy of every breath we could ever breathe, we live for you.
Sang about there, the presence of God. Some of you here, you've experienced that presence. If you don't know the Lord, it's sometimes strange, but that's his presence. If you want to know more, sign up for the Alpha course. Come and learn more about what it is to know that you're seen by God and loved by God. So if that's you, please sign up, speak to Jeanette afterwards. Those online, you're welcome to come along as well. And there's time to pray after the service up the front here. The garden's open. Go and get some air if you want some. Hang around and talk to one another. And we will see you next week. But I do want to close just with a special prayer, especially for those teachers going back. You know, the next generation, they put so much, don't they? Our schools. And in Brazil, when actually education isn't something that everyone has access to, and it makes you realize how much we do have. So, Lord, I just want to thank you that we have an education system. Lord, it's easy to see what doesn't work. But Lord, we are so blessed in so many ways. And Lord, we do pray you'll sort out all these problems with the buildings, Lord. But we thank you that we have school buildings in existence, that all of our children have access to education, Lord. And we pray a blessing on every one of our young ones, whether they're going off to school, to college, to university. Lord, may they recognize that's the route through. And you will achieve so much through them. May they delight in the learning. May they make new friends and hold on to existing ones. Bless all those that put so much into their lives. We pray a blessing on every teacher, every professor, everyone that is part of the education system, from the person that cleans the school ready for them to arrive, to the caretakers, to the teachers, to those that set the curriculums, to those that do the marking. Lord, that vast army that are educating our next generation, we pray a blessing over every one of them. In Jesus' name, amen. See you next week.